The Docks, New York City, 1946. Sullivan sometimes wished he were back working the meatball beat in Little Italy. Ryan paid him well, sure, but having to dodge G-men on the docks was not his idea of a good time. It was a bracing, misty evening, supposed to be spring but didn't feel much like it. The waves were choppy and the gulls were huddled on the pylons with their beaks under their wings, their feathers ruffled in the cold northeast wind. Three hulking great ships were tied up at the beat-up old dock, all freighters. This was not one of the fashionable wharfs with passenger liners and pretty girls waving hankies. Just a couple of red-faced, sour-looking salts in pea jackets tramping by, trailing cigarette smoke, boots crunching on old gull droppings. Sullivan walked up to the gangplank of the Olympian, the largest of the three ships in the fleet Ryan had bought for his secretive North Atlantic project. He waved at the armed guard Pinelli, huddled into a big coat on the top deck. Pinelli glanced down at him and nodded. Reuben Grevy, head engineer for the Wales Brothers, was waiting on the lower deck at the top of the gangplank. Grevy was a fussy, pinch-mouthed, bespectacled little man in a rather showy, cream-colored overcoat. Sullivan hesitated, glancing back down the dock, just making out the dark figure of the man who'd been following him. The guy in the slouch hat and trench coat was about 70 yards down the wharf, pretending to be interested in the ships creaking at their moorings. Sullivan had hoped he'd dodge the son of a bitch earlier, but there he was, lighting a pipe for a bit of realistic spycraft. The pipe smoker had been tailing Sullivan since he'd gotten a cab at Grand Central, and maybe before. There wasn't much the guy could learn from following him here. The ship was already loaded. The feds would never get an inspection warrant before it set sail at midnight. And what would they make of the prefabricated metal parts, giant pipes, and enormous pressure-resistant sheets of transparent synthetics? It was all stuff you could legitimately call export goods. Only, it wasn't being exported across the ocean. It was being exported to the bottom of the ocean. Sullivan shook his head, thinking about the whole North Atlantic project. It was a crazy idea, but when Ryan put his mind into something, it got done. And Sullivan owed the great man a lot. Almost ruined him, getting kicked out of the NYPD. Shouldn't have refused to grease those palms. They'd set him up to look like a crook, fired him, and taken away his pension. Left him with almost nothing. Sullivan took to gambling. And then his wife ran off with the last of his dough. He'd been thinking about eating a bullet when he crossed paths with the great man 2 years earlier. Sullivan reached into his coat pocket for the flask, then remembered it was empty. Maybe he could get a drink from Grevy. Sullivan waved at Grevy and climbed the gangplank. They shook hands. Grevy's grip was soft, fingers puny in Sullivan's big grasp.
Sullivan!
Professor?
How many times? I'm not a professor. I have a doctorate in... Never mind. You know someone's shadowing you on the dock back there.
Different gumshoe this time. Probably FBI, IRS.
He turned his collar up.
Kinda chilly out here.
Come along then. We'll have a drink.
Sullivan nodded resignedly. He knew what Grevy's idea of a drink was. Watered brandy. Sullivan needed a double scotch. His father had sworn by Irish whiskey, but Sullivan was a scotch man.
Sure, the black betrayal of your heritage, it is,
his pa would say. A steady liquid diet of Irish whiskey had killed the old rascal at 50. Grevy led him along a companionway to his cabin, which was not much warmer. Most of the little oval room that wasn't the narrow bed was taken up by a table covered with overlapping blueprints, sketches, graphs, intricate designs. The Wales Brothers' designs sometimes looked like Manhattan mated with London, but with the power of a cathedral. The designs were overly fancy for Sullivan's taste. Maybe he'd get to like it once it was done, if it ever was. Grevy took a bottle from under his pillow and poured them two slugs in glasses, and Sullivan eased the stuff down.
We need to be ready for any kind of raid,
Grevy said, distractedly looking past Sullivan at the blueprints, his mind already backed in the world of the Wales design, and very nearly Ryan's new world. Sullivan shrugged.
With any luck, he'll get the place finished before they can screw with us. The foundation's already laid. Power's flowing, right? Most of the stuff's in place on the support ships, just a few more shipments.
Grevy snorted, surprising Sullivan by pouring himself a second drink, and
irritating Sullivan by not offering him one.
You have no idea of the work, the risk. It's enormous. It's the very soul of innovation, and I need more men. We're already behind schedule.
You'll get some more. Ryan's hired another man to supervise the foundational work, he calls it, a man named McDonough. He's going to put him on the North Atlantic project once he proves he can really be trusted.
McDonough? Never heard of him. Don't tell me. He's not another apple picked from an orange tree.
A what?
You know Ryan. He has his own notions of picking men. Sometimes they're remarkable, and well, sometimes they're... strange.
Sullivan scowled. Like me?
No, no, no.
Meaning, yes, yes, yes. But it was true. Ryan had a way of recruiting black sheep, people who showed great potential but needed that extra chance. They all had a spirit of independence, were disillusioned with the status quo, and sometimes willing to skirt the law.
The problem, Sullivan said, is that the government thinks Ryan is hiding something because he's trying to keep people from finding out where these shipments are going and what they're for. And he is hiding something, but not what they think.
Greavy went to the blueprints, shuffling through them with one hand, his eyes gleaming behind his thick spectacles.
The strategic value of such a construction is significant in a world where we're likely to go toe-to-toe with the Soviets. And Mr. Ryan doesn't want any outsiders going down there to report on what he's building. He wants to run things his way, specifically once it's set up without interference. That's the whole point. Or to be more accurate, he wants to set it up to run itself, to let the laissez-faire principle free. He figures if the government know about it, they'll infiltrate, and then there's the union types, communist organizers. Suppose they would have wormed their way in. The best way to keep people like that out is to keep it completely secret from them. Another thing Ryan doesn't want any outsiders to know about is some of the new technology. You'd be amazed at what he's got. New inventions he could patent and make a fortune on, but he's holding back for this project.
Where's he getting all these new inventions?
Oh, he's been recruiting people for years. Who do you think designed all those new dynamos of his?
Well, it's his call, Sullivan said, looking wistfully into his empty glass. Weak brandy or not, a drink was a drink. You've been working for him twice as long as I have. He don't tell me much.
He likes information to be compartmentalized on this project. Keeps a secret better.
Sullivan crossed to the porthole and peered out. Saw his shadow out there, still clamping that pipe in his mouth. But now the G-Man was pacing by the Olympian, looking the freighter up and down. Son of a bitch is still out there. Doesn't seem empowered to do anything but ogle the ship.
I've got to meet the Wales brothers. You know what they're like. Artists. All too aware of their own genius.
He frowned at the blueprints. Sullivan could see he was jealous of the Waleses. Greavy sniffed.
If there's nothing else, I'd better get on with it. Unless there's something else besides this new man Ryan's taken on.
Who? Oh, McDonough. No, I'm here to confirm the time you ship out. Ryan wanted me to come down personally. He's beginning to think they might be listening on the telephones somehow. I'm thinking if you can leave earlier than midnight, it'd be better.
As soon as the captain's back. I expect him within the hour.
Leave as soon as you can. Maybe they'll get a warrant after all. I don't think they'll find anything illegal, but if Ryan wants to keep them from knowing what he's up to, the less they see, the better.
Very well, but who could imagine what he's up to? Jules Verne? Certainly not these drones at the IRS, but Sullivan, I assure you, Ryan is correct. If they knew what he really has in mind, they'd be quite worried, particularly considering how little help he gave the Allies in the war.
He took no sides at all. He didn't care for Hitler, nor the Japs neither.
Still, he showed no special loyalty to the United States, and who can blame him? Look at the wreckage the Ant Society made of Europe for the second time in the century. And the horror of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, I can't wait to leave all that behind.
Greavy escorted Sullivan towards the door.
Ryan has every intention of creating something that will grow and grow, first across the seabed, then in time, above the surface of the sea. When they've done such damage to themselves, these so-called nations of the earth, that they can no longer pose a threat, Until then, he is right to mistrust them, because he is creating something that will compete with them, a whole new society, indeed in time, a whole new world, one which will utterly replace the vile, squirming anthill humanity has become.
New York City, 1946.
Merton, get out of my bar.
Merton was gaping at Frank Gorland from behind the beer-stained desk of the Clangers' smoky little office. Harve Merton was a man with a large round head and thick lips in a skinny body and a brown turtleneck sweater. Hell, he looked like a damn turtle, but a turtle in a bowler hat.
What the hell you mean, your bar?
He asked, tamping a cigarette out in a butt-filled ashtray.
I'm the owner, ain't I? As of tonight, anyhow.
What the hell you mean you're the owner, Gorland?
The man who called himself Frank Gorland smiled without humor and leaned against the frame of the closed door.
You know any expressions besides, what the hell?
You're about to sign this bar over to me is what the hell.
Gorland ran a hand over his bald head. Prickly, he needed to shave it. He took the papers from his coat, all legal down to the last period, and dropped them on Merton's desk.
That look familiar? You signed it.
Merton stared at the papers, eyes widening.
That was you? Hudson Loans? Nobody told me that was...
A loan's a loan. What I seem to recall is you were drunk when you signed it. You needed some money to pay off your gambling vig. A big fucking vig it was too, Merton.
You were there that night? I don't remember.
You remember getting the money, don't you?
It don't count if I was drunk.
Merton, if there was no business done drunk in this town, half its business wouldn't get done.
I think you put something in my drink. That's what I think. The next day, I felt...
Stop whining. You cashed the check, didn't you? You got the loan, couldn't pay the interest, time's up. Now this place is mine. It's all there. Black and white. This dump was your collateral.
Look, Mr. Gorland.
Merton licked his thick lips.
Don't think I disrespect you. I know you've hustled, worked your way to a good thing, this end of town, but you can't just take a man's business.
No. My attorneys can. They'll come after you hammer and tongs, pal.
He grinned.
Hammer, tongs, and Klein. Attorneys at law.
Merton seemed to shrivel in his seat.
Okay. What do you want from me?
Not what I want. What I'm taking. I told you I want the bar. I own a bookkeeping operation, I own a drugstore, but I don't have a bar. And I like the Clanger. Lots of dirt on the fights, what's with the boxing setup and all. Might be useful. Now, you call that fat-ass bartender of yours in here. Tell him he's got a new boss.
Gorland, Barris, Whiston, Moskowitz, Wang. Just some of the names he's had in the last few years. His own name, quite another Frank, seemed like it belonged to somebody else. Keep 'em guessing, that was his way. The Clanger wasn't just a cash cow. It was the place for Frank Gorland to hear the right conversations. It was just a short walk from the docks, but it wasn't just a nautical bar. There was a big boxing bell on the wall behind the bar. When they tapped a new keg, the bell was loudly clanged, and the beer lovers came running, sometimes from down the street. Best German-style brew in New York City. The walls of the dusty, cave-like bar were decorated with worn-out boxing gloves, frayed ropes from rings, black-and-white photos of old-time boxers going back to John L. Sullivan. He had a bartender, an old Irish lush named Mulrooney, working down at the other end. But Gorland liked to work the bar himself so he could hear the talk. Good for his bookmaking action. And you never know how it might fit the next grift.
When you serve a beer, cock an ear.
The talk at the crowded bar tonight was full of how Joe Lewis, the brown bomber, back from the war with a pocket full of nothing and a big tax debt, was going to defend his world heavyweight title against the new champion, Billy Kahn. And how the retired Jack Johnson, first black man to win the heavyweight champ title, had died 2 days before in a car accident. None of which was what Gorland needed to know, but there were a couple of guys here who had the skinny on the up-and-comer, Neil Steele, versus the fading boxing circuit bum, Charlie Riggles. Gorland had heard a rumor that Steele might be throwing the fight, and he had a theory about how that information might pay off, way past the usual payoff.
Only Gorland needed more assurance that Steele was taking the fall. Gorland hated bartending because it was actual, physical work. A great grifter should never have to do real work, but he wiped down the bar, made small talk, he served beer, and cocked an ear. The jukebox was finishing a rollicking Duke Ellington number, and in the brief interval before it switched over to an Ernie Bubbles Whitman big band cut, Gorland zeroed in on the conversation of the two wise guys in the white ties and pinstripes, whispering over their sambiocas. He wiped an imaginary spill at the bar, edging closer.
"But can we count on Steele?"
said the one some called Twitchy. He twitched his pencil-thin mustache.
"Think he's going to challenge the bomber next year."
"So let him challenge. He can lose one fight. He needs the payoff. Needs it big,"
said the chunkier one of the two, Snort Bianchi, with a snort. Bianchi scowled, seeing the bartender hanging around too nearby.
"Hey, bartender, there's a broad over there trying to get a drink. How about you fuck off and serve her?"
"I'm the owner here, gents," Gorland said, smiling. "You want to come back in here and show some respect for the establishment? Wasn't good to let these greasers get the upper hand."
Gorland leaned closer to the wise guys, adding in a murmur,
"Psst, maybe you better take a powder if these feds are looking for you."
He nodded towards the door where an FBI flatfoot by the name of Voss stood in his gray snap-brim and overcoat, glaring about with his piggish little eyes. He looked about as undercover as the Statue of Liberty. The wise guys slipped out the back way as the federal agent made his way to the bar. He was reaching into his coat when Gorland said,
"Don't bother with the badge, Voss, I remember you."
He didn't want badges flashed anywhere near him if he could avoid it. Voss shrugged and dropped his hand. He leaned across the bar so he could be heard over the noise.
"Word on the street is, this here's your joint now."
"That's right," Gorland said evenly. "Lock, stock, and leaky barrels."
"What are you calling yourself now? Gorland, still?"
"My name's Frank Gorland, you know that."
"That's not the name you had when we tried to connect you to that interstate bookmaking operation."
"You want to see my birth certificate?"
"Our man's already seen it, says maybe it was forged."
"Yeah, but he's not sure. Not much of an expert if he doesn't know for sure."
Voss snorted.
"You got that right. You're going to offer me a drink or not?"
Gorland shrugged, decided not to make a smart remark about drinking on duty.
"Bourbon?"
"Good guessing."
Gorland poured the G-Man a double.
"You didn't come here to catch drinks."
"You got that right, too."
He took down a slug, grimaced appreciatively, and went on.
"I figure you're gonna hear stuff in a place like this. You give me something now and then, we might lay off finding out who the hell you really are."
Gorland chuckled, but he felt a chill. He didn't want his pass poked into.
"If I tip you, it'll be because I'm a good citizen. No other reason."
"Anything special going on?" Voss crooked a finger, leaned even closer across the bar. Gorland hesitated, then he leaned close. Voss spoke right in his ear.
"You hear anything about the docks? About some kind of big secret project happening down there? Maybe bankrolled by Andrew Ryan? North Atlantic project, millions of bucks flowing out to sea?"
"Nah," Gorland said. He hadn't heard about it, but the millions of bucks and the name Andrew Ryan had gotten his attention. "I hear anything, Voss, I'll tell you."
"What kind of deal is he up to?"
"That's something we don't... something you don't need to know."
Gorland straightened up.
"You're killing my back here with this. Listen, I gotta make it look like, you know..."
He'd been seen talking to the Fed a little too chummily. Voss nodded just slightly. He understood.
"Listen, Flatfoot," Gorland shouted as the jukebox changed records. "You won't find out anything from me. Now charge me with something or buzz out of my place."
Some of the customers laughed, some grinned and nodded. Voss shrugged.
"You better watch your step, Gorland."
He turned and walked out, playing his part. Only he was going to find out one of these days that Frank Gorland wasn't going to play along with anything the feds wanted. He'd feed them some hooey and find out himself what Andrew Ryan was up to. That kind of money. Must be some way to tap into it. Especially as this was Frank Gorland's territory. He was owed. He didn't hear anything about Ryan for a couple days. But one day, he heard a drunk blonde Chippy muttering about,
"Mr. Fat Cat, Ryan. God damn him."
As she frantically waved her empty glass at him.
"Hey, where's my drinky?"
demanded the blonde.
"What do you have, darling?"
"What'll I have?" he says.
The frowsy blonde slurred, flipping a big must curl out of her eyes. Her eyeshadow had been running from crying. She was a snub-nosed little thing, but might be worth a roll in the hay. Only the last time he'd banged a drunk, she'd thrown up all over him.
"I'll have a scotch, if I can have my man back,"
she sobbed.
"That's what I'll have. Dead, 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 dead. And no one from that Ryan crew is saying why."
Gorland tried out his best look of sympathy.
"Lost your man, did you? That'll get you a big one on the house, sweet cakes."
He poured her a double scotch.
"Hey, spritz some goddamn soda in there. What do you think, I'm a lush because I take a free drink?"
"Soda it is, darling. There you go."
He waited as she drank down half of it in one gulp. The sequins were coming off the shoulder straps of her second-hand silver-blue gown, and one of her bosoms was in danger of flopping out of the decolletage. He could see a little tissue sticking up.
"I just want my Irving back,"
she said, her head sagging down over the drink. Lucky the song coming on the juke was a Dorsey & Sinatra crooner, soft enough he could make her out.
"Just want him back."
He absent-mindedly poured a couple more drinks for the sailors at her side, their white caps cocked rakishly as they argued over bar dice and tossed money at him.
"What become of the unfortunate soul?"
Gorland asked, pocketing the money and wiping the bar.
"Lost at sea, was he?"
She gawped at him.
"How'd you know that? You a mind reader?"
Gorland winked.
"A little fishy, told me."
She put a finger to the side of her nose and gave him an elaborate wink back.
"So you heard about Ryan's little fun show. My Irving shipped out with hardly a goodbye. Said he had to do some kind of diving for them Ryan people. That was where he got his lettuce, see? What's they call deep sea diving? Learned it in the Navy salvage. They'd said it'd be pennies from heaven. Just a month at sea, doing some kind of underwater building and..."
"Underwater building? You mean like pylons for a dock?"
"I dunno, but I tell you, he came back the first time, real spooked, wouldn't talk about it. Said it was much of his life was worth to talk, see? But he told me one thing."
She wagged a finger at him and closed one eye.
"Them ships down at Dock 17, they're hiding something from the feds. And he was plenty scared about it. What if he was in on something criminal, not even knowing, and he took the fall? And then I get a telegram, a little piece of paper, saying he ain't coming back. Accident on the job. Buried at sea."
Her head wobbled on her neck, and her voice was interrupted by hiccuping.
"And that's the end of my Irving. I'm supposed to just swallow that? Well, I went over to the place that hired him. Seaworthy Construction, they was called. And they threw me out. Treated me like I was some kind of tramp. All I wanted was what was coming to me. I came from South Jersey, and let me tell you, we get what we're owed, cause..."
She went on and on in that vein for a while, losing the Ryan thread. Then a zoot suitor put a bebop number on the juke and started whooping it up. The noise drowned her out, and pretty soon she was cradling her head in the bar, snoring. Gorland had one of those intuitions, that this was the door to something big. His lush bartender came weaving in, and Gorland turned the place over, tossing over his apron. He had a grift to set up. First thing Gorland noticed coming into the sweat-reeking prep room for the fight was that hangdog look on Steele's face. Good. Sitting on the rubdown table, getting his gloves laced by a black trainer, the scarred, barrel-chested boxer looked like his best friend had died and his old lady too. Gorland tucked a fiver into the black guy's hand and tilted his head towards the door.
"I'll tie his gloves on for him, bud."
The guy took the hint and beat it. Steele was looking Gorland up and down, his expression hinting he'd like to practice his punching right there. Only, he didn't know this was Frank Gorland, what with the disguise. Right now, the man the East Side knew as Frank Gorland was going by.
"My name's Lucio Fabrici," Gorland said, tying Steele's gloves nice and tight.
"Bianchi sent me."
"Bianchi? What for? I told him not an hour ago, it was a done deal."
Steele showed no sign of doubting that he was talking to Lucio Fabrici. a mobster working with Bianchi. Fabrizi had gone to great lengths for this disguise. The pinstripe suit, the toothpick stuck in the corner of his mouth, the spats, the toupee, the thin mustache, a high-quality, theatrical mustache, carefully stuck on with spirit gum. But mostly, it was his voice. Just the right Little Italy intonation, and that carefully tuned facial expression that said, "We're pals, you and I, unless I have to kill ya." Not hard for him to pull off the character, or almost any character. Running off from the orphanage, he'd taken a job as a stage boy in a vaudeville theater. Stuck it out for 3 years, though they paid him in pennies and sausages. He'd slept on a pile of ropes backstage, but it had been worth it. He'd watched the actors, the comics, even a famous Shakespearean type who played half a dozen parts in this one-man show. Young Frank had sucked it all up like a sponge. Makeup, costumes, the works. But what most impressed him was the fact that people in the audience believed. For a few minutes, they believed this laudanum-addicted Welsh actor was Hamlet. That kind of power really impressed young Frank. He'd set himself to learn it. Judging from Steele's reaction, he'd learned it good. "Look here, Fabrizi, if Bianchi's gonna Welsh on my cut, I won't take it. This is hard enough for me." "You ever hear of a triple cross, kid? Bianchi's changed his mind." Gorland lowered his voice, glanced to make sure the door was closed. "Bianchi doesn't want you to throw the fight. We've let it out you're throwing the fight, so we can bet the other way, see? You'll get your cut of the proceeds and double." Steele's mouth hung open. He jumped to his feet, clapped his gloved hands together.
"You mean it? Say that's swell. I'll knock that lug's socks off."
"You do that, Steely. I hear him calling you. Get out there and nail him early. First chance. Make it a knockout in the first round."
Steele was delighted.
"Tell Bianchi I'll deliver. And how? A KO first round, ha!"
Half an hour later, Gorland was at the bookie operation in the basement of the drugstore. Gorland and Garcia, his chief bookie, were in the room behind the betting counters, talking quietly as Maury took bets at the window. Two or three freight ship deckhands, judging by their watch caps and tattoos, stood in line to place their bets, passing a flask and yammering.
"I don't know, boss,"
Garcia said, scratching his head. Garcia was a chubby, second-generation Cuban in a cheap three-piece suit, chomping a cigar that had never been anywhere near Cuba.
"I get how knowing about Steele throwing the fight'll get us paid if we place our own bets through our own guys,"
Garcia was saying.
"But boss, I don't see how you're going to get the kind of money out of it you're talking about."
"'Cause he isn't gonna throw the fight. All the smart mob money'll be on him losing, and we'll bet on him winning. And we'll take him big time when he surprises him."
Garcia blinked.
"They'll take it out of Steele's hide, boss."
"And how's that my worry? Just you make sure the mob's up to their neck betting against Steele. They're gonna be sad little monkeys when they lose, but they won't trace it to us. If you see Harley, tell him to keep an eye on that poker game up at the hotel. Got some real big money suckers coming in."
He walked over to Maury to have a gander at the take, and he heard a couple of the dock workers talking over their flask.
"Sure, Ryan's hiring big down there. It's a hot ticket, pal. Big paydays. But the problem is, real QT stuff. Can't talk about the job, and it's dangerous, too. Somewhere in the North Atlantic, Iceland way."
Gorland's ears pricked up at that. He slipped outside by the side door and set himself to wait. Less than a minute later, a couple of deckhands came out, weather-beaten guys in watch caps and pea jackets, headed for the docks. The deck rats didn't notice him following. They were too busy whistling at a group of girls, having a smoke across the street. He shadowed the sailors close to the dockside, then hung back in the shadows of a doorway, sussing the scene out. The deckhands went aboard one of the ships, but it was another one that caught Gorland's eye. A new freighter with a lot of activity on its decks, getting ready to cast loose. The name on the bow was the Olympian. That was one of Ryan's ships. There was a guy in the lee of a sack of crates near the loading dock, smoking a pipe. Something about him said G-Man. It wasn't Voss, probably one of his men, if Gorland was any judge of cop flesh. If Andrew Ryan was attracting G-Men, he must be up to something of questionable legal status, which meant at the very least he could be blackmailed if Gorland could find out exactly what to blackmail him for.
seemed like the agent was watching the two guys arguing at the gangplank of Ryan's freighter, but he wasn't close enough to listen in without them noticing. Gorlin tilted his hat so the G-man wouldn't see his face and strolled over, hands in his pockets, weaving a bit, making like he was drunk.
"Maybe I can give me some work on one of these ships," Gorlin said, slurring his words. Maybe. Backbreaking work they got. Don't care for it. Maybe they need a social director."
He did a good drunk, and all three men discounted him immediately as he approached. Gorlin paused near the gangplank, muttering to himself as he pretended to struggle with lighting a cigarette. All the while, he listened to the argument between the man standing on the roped gangplank and a mustachioed man on the dock, who looked like he might be a deckhand.
"I just ain't shipping out to that place again, and that's all there is to it," snarled the deckhand in the black pea coat.
He wore a knit cap on his head and a handlebar mustache on his upper lip. A swarthy type. Eyebrows merged in a single black bar, but getting old, maybe. Skin leathery, hair salt and pepper, hand trembling as he jabbed a finger at the ship's officer.
"You ain't going to make me go out there. Too goddamned risky."
"Why, percentage-wise, they're losing less people than building the Brooklyn Bridge," said the officer. "I have Mr. Greavy's word on that. Stop being such a coward."
"I don't mind being on the ship, but in that hell down below, not me."
"There's no use trying to say you'll only take the job if you stay on the ship. It's what Greavy says that goes. If he says you go down, you go down."
"Then you go down in my place, and you wrestle with the devil. It's unholy what he's trying to do down there."
"If you leave here now, matey, you don't get paid a penny more. Get aboard this instant, we sail in 10 minutes, or you can say goodbye to your contract."
2 weeks' salary for my life? Pah.
"You won't die down there. We've had one run of bad luck is all."
"I say it again, pah. Goodbye to you, Mr. Forrester."
The deckhand stalked off, and Gorlin realized the ship's officer was glaring at him with unconcealed suspicion.
"You, what are you doing hanging around here?"
Gorlin flicked his cigarette butt into the sea. He grinned drunkenly.
"Just having a smoke, matey."
He set off to follow the deckhand, wondering what he'd stumbled into. It was like a trail of coins gleaming on a moonlit path. If he kept following the shiny little clues, he'd find the money bag they were leaking from. Gorlin knew this trail could lead him to trouble, maybe jail, but he was a restless man, unhappy if he wasn't out on an edge. He either stayed busy working the game or lost himself in a woman's arms. Otherwise, he started thinking too much, like about his old man dumping him in that orphanage when he was a boy. The deckhand turned the corner of one of the loading docks to go up the access road. It was a foggy night, and there was no one else on the short side road to the avenue. No one to see. Frank Gorland had two approaches to getting what he wanted from life: long-term planning and creative improvisation. He saw a possibility. A foot-long piece of 1-inch diameter metal pipe fallen off some truck. It was just lying in the gutter, calling to him. He scooped up the piece of pipe and hurried to catch up with the slouching shape of the deckhand. He stepped up behind the man, grabbed his collar, jerked him, slightly off balance without knocking him over.
"Hey!"
the man yelped. Gorland held the deckhand firmly in place and pressed the end of the cold metal pipe to the back of his neck.
"Freeze,"
Gorlin growled, altering his voice. He put steel and officiousness into it.
"You turn around, mister. You try to run, and I'll pull the trigger and separate your backbones with a bullet."
The man froze.
Don't shoot. What do you want? I don't have but a dollar on me."
"You think I'm some crooked dock rat? I'm a federal agent. Now don't even twitch."
Gorlin let go of the deckhand's collar, reached into his own coat pocket, took out his wallet, flipped it open, flashed the worthless special officer badge he used when he needed bogus authority. He flicked it in front of the guy's face, not letting him have a real look at it.
"You see that?"
Gorlin demanded.
"Yes, sir."
He put the wallet away and went on.
"Now hear this, sailor. You're in deep shit for working on that crooked project of Ryan's."
They told me it was all legal. All legal.
"They told you it was a secret, too. You think it's legal to keep secrets from Uncle Sam?"
"No, I guess not. I mean, well, I don't know nothing about it. Just that they're building something down there, and
It's a dangerous job down them tunnels under the sea.
Tunnels? Under the sea? For what?
For construction, the foundations. I don't know why he's doing it. None of the men do. He tells them only what they need to know. I heard Greavy talking to one of them scientist types. All I can tell you is what I heard.
And that was?
That Ryan's building a city under the sea down there.
A what?
Like a colony under the goddamn ocean. And they're laying out all kind of stuff down there. It doesn't seem possible, but he's doing it. I heard he's spending hundreds of millions. Maybe getting into billions. He's spending more money than any man's ever spent building anything.
Gorlin's mouth went dry as he contemplated it, and his heart thumped.
Where is this thing?
Out in the North Atlantic. They keep us below decks when we go, so we don't see exactly. I ain't even sure. Cold as death out there it is, but he's got the devil's own heat coming up. Steam comes up some ways, and sulfur fumes and the like. Some took sick from them fumes. Men have died down there building that thing.
How do you know how much he's spending?
I was carrying bags into Mr. Greavy's office on the platform ship, and I was curious. Like, I hear some talking.
The what kind of ship?
That's what they call it. Platform ship. A platform to launch their slinkers. The Olympian there, it supplies the platform ships. Bathyspheres, they is.
Bathyspheres? You're lying to me.
No, officer, I swear it.
Then get out of here, run. And tell no one you spoke to me, or you'll go right to jail.
The man went, scurrying away, and Gorlin was left in a state of mute amazement.
Ryan is building a city under the sea.